This is Duke University.
Good afternoon. I'm delighted to invite you to Breaking News, Truck 71, Europe and the Refugee Crisis. This is a panel that has been organized by DUMESC, the Duke University Middle East Studies Center. My name is Miriam Cooke. I'm professor of Arab cultures in the Department of Asian and Middle East Studies at Duke University. So, Truck 71, what are we talking about? In 1963, Hossein Kanafani, a Palestinian short story writer, spokesperson for the Palestine Liberation Organization, wrote a story that has now become mandatory reading for anybody who wants to know anything about the Middle East. It was called Rijal fi Shams, Men in the Sun. It was a story about three Palestinian men who left their land and decided that they would try their fortune in Kuwait, Kuwait being like Dick Whittington's London, streets paved in gold. And they arrive after an arduous journey in Basra. And from Basra in the south of Iraq, that we now know, of course, because we have become so familiar with Iraq since 2003, from Basra is another arduous journey, and it takes one to Kuwait across the desert. During that trip, they have a smuggler who takes them, and they are in a truck. The truck was a water truck, and it's unbearably hot inside the truck. And after the second protracted wait at a police station, the driver comes back, a well-intentioned man, but making his fortune on the misfortunes of his people. He comes back to find that the three men in his truck are dead. Now, until, I would say, August of this year, the story was almost too much. It was so grim that it could not be true. And of course, what we learned 2 weeks ago was that not only was that probably true many times, but that in fact, in Europe, in August of 2015, 71 refugees could burn up alive from the heat inside a sealed truck. And so that is where our title for today's breaking news session comes from. Never before have so many people been outside their homes, and many of those who are outside their homes are Syrians. So a very, very brief background on the Syrian crisis. It emerged out of the Arab Spring that started in Tunisia in December of 2010, moved by contagion and swiftly across the Arab world. So to Egypt in January of 2011, Bahrain, Yemen, Libya, and almost unbelievably to those of us who knew anything about what life was like inside authoritarian Syria, to Syria also in March of 2011. But what happened very soon after the March 17th beginning of the demonstrations in Syria, Bashar Assad had already learned the lesson of his neighbors. He'd learned the lessons from Tunisia, Ben Ali, who ran away, Mubarak in Egypt, who was toppled, Saleh in Yemen, who also was toppled, Gaddafi in Libya, who, as many will remember, was pulled out of a sewer and killed by the people. And Bashar Assad continues not to be prepared to follow their fate. In fact, what he did almost immediately was to tighten control to a ruthless repression. So far, we have 260,000 who are dead. And I always have a problem with these figures because they always seem to be much less than they actually are. 9 million who are internally displaced, 4 million refugees, countless numbers in prison, and who knows how many disappeared. To add to all this, we have Islamic State, encouraged by outside forces, some pretty hair-raising encouragements from extremists in the region to encourage Islamist extremists to go to fight against Assad. And of course, what they have done in the process is to justify Bashar Assad's crushing of the opposition by, in fact, claiming that what he is doing is saving the world from Islamic extremism. So many have said what has happened in Syria is a civil war. Many who were actually part of the revolution in the beginning might not agree. But from a humanitarian point of view, it doesn't matter. What does matter is a tsunami of misery pouring out of Syria to its three neighbors, Turkey, Jordan, and Lebanon. And in Lebanon, the Syrians, who now number 1.5 million, make up almost a third of the country's total population now. So we meet today, deliberately, on the 14th of September. One reason was not timed. We didn't know this would happen. The other was. So we meet today, a day after Germany closed its 500-mile border with Austria in violation of the 1985 Schengen Treaty that guaranteed a borderless Europe. And of course, we now have three countries that have followed: Hungary, Slovakia, and the Netherlands. The reason we picked today is that when we decided to have this session about 10 days ago, we had heard that the EU interior ministers were going to be meeting today to discuss what was going on and to try and deal with the crisis. As far as I can tell, and maybe the panelists today will have better news than I have, they seem to have failed on everything. They seem to have failed to agree on the proposal of the President of the European Commission plan to share 120,000 refugees across 22 countries. Remember that Germany had committed to 800,000 in a year. They have failed to agree to the outsourcing, which I'm not sure sounded so great anyhow, outsourcing asylum processing, especially to Africa, to what they call transit countries in Africa, where they would have to build refugee camps. So, to help us to think through this crisis in the Middle East and in Europe today, we have six activists who have devoted, or who are planning to devote their lives to humanitarian work. And in order of presentation, they will be Robin Kirk from the Duke Human Rights Center and the Franklin Humanities Institute. And then, so that's from Duke. And then from UNC, Niklaus Steiner, who's the director of the Center for Global Initiatives. From UNC also, visiting for this year, Dilshad al-Gaaf, who is a research advisor for conflict and disaster prevention. Back to Duke, we have our own Jeffrey Mock, who is, in this case, representing the Amnesty International, their Middle East representative here. And then we have two undergraduate students, one from UNC and one from Duke. So we have Sama Naqib from Duke and Peter Cooke from UNC. I hope that each one of them will read out the title of their paper so that you are clear what the subject is, what the title of their paper is. But in conclusion, I would like to dedicate our work at Duke and UNC, as we have done last year, to the three young students, Dea Barakat and Yusur Imrazan Abu Salha. They were called the three winners, who were murdered in February because of who they were and because of what they were doing. Like the students on our panel today, they were planning to work with Syrian refugees. May their short lives continue to inspire us all in what we are doing today and in the years to come. So I would like to now invite Robin Cooke to present.
Thank you very much, Miriam, and thank you for that lovely dedication. That's wonderful. I wish I had a paper, but I have our notes. But I wanted to talk a little bit about just the human rights sort of language that's being used in reference to this crisis, and maybe explain a little bit how it fits and how it doesn't fit. I just found this cartoon this morning, and it sort of satisfies the English major in me, which says that, you know, these definitions are so slippery. And are really being misused a lot, especially in the coverage of this crisis. So I'm going to talk a little bit about the 1951 Refugee Treaty and then the 1967 Protocol and then what's been going on in Europe around these issues. You know, a colleague of mine, Catherine Sickink, at the who's the author of a book called The Justice Cascade, has talked about human rights treaties and trials and truth commissions as a justice cascade. In other words, a meeting, a network of various levels of human rights accountability that create what we kind of now know as the modern regime of human rights. And I think we can see this crisis in a similar sort of vein. It's not just a refugee treaty or the Schengen Agreement. It's this network of different sorts of jurisdictions, assumptions, pledges, that should be protecting people, but that aren't. And there are real solid reasons why people are not moving to protect refugees in this particular crisis. I started, when I worked for Human Rights Watch for many years, one of the crises that I covered was the displacement of both Peruvian and Colombians in the context of the wars in Peru in the 1980s and then Colombia in the 1990s and 2000s. In those cases, we had very few refugees, but we had millions of displaced people. So I wanted to start just with some definitions. You know, in the context of international law around people who are moving, we have a couple of categories. One, which this cartoon alludes to, is the definition of migrant. So these people are moving primarily for economic reasons. They're not politically repressed. They're not fleeing civil war. They're going from one country to the next for economic opportunity. And that has characterized, for instance, the migration from Mexico and Central America for many years, people who are coming to the United States for better lives. But then you have a category called asylum seeker. Now, asylum seeker is protected under treaties, but an asylum seeker is specifically one person or one person and their family who come because who leave their countries because there's a specific and provable threat against them. In Colombia, often we get death threats with somebody's name written on the death threat. So that person could then go to an embassy, say the Canadian embassy or the United States embassy or the Swedish embassy, and say, look, I have a fear that I'm specifically going to be killed, specifically because of what I've done politically or as a journalist or what have you. I would like to ask your country for asylum. And then we have a third category, which is the category we're talking about today, refugee. What is a refugee? A refugee is someone, and there's a couple of sort of details that mean refugee. It's someone who is being persecuted for political reasons, religious reasons, political, ethnic reasons, someone who isn't safe in their country. And the second part of the definition, you actually have to leave your country to be a refugee. You can't declare yourself a refugee from inside your country. In that sense, it's quite different from the asylum seeker. An asylum seeker can say within their own country, I'm going to search for asylum. A refugee is defined by the fact that they cross a border. Now, in 1951, this would have been 3 years after the signing of the Universal Declaration of Human Rights, we had one of the first major human rights treaties, the Refugee Convention. But it was very specific. It dealt only with refugees in Europe up to 1951. Anyone who had become a refugee after 1951 was not protected by the refugee treaty. So it was very local. It was very much targeted to the aftermath of World War II. It was very Europe-focused. But in 1960, by 1967, it was clear that we had a much larger problem. So you have a 1967 protocol, which essentially says, look, we're going to remove the time limit on this, and we're going to adopt a refugee convention for everyone. But I think that we still have, it's one of the weakest human rights treaties. It has several really important flaws, and we're seeing those flaws work out on the ground today in Europe. For instance, you have a right, as someone who has left your country, to ask for refugee status. That is a right. But the country that you're asking for refugee status in does not have to guarantee your refugee status. It's optional. So it's essentially a bridge with the middle missing. So countries can choose to accept you as a refugee, or they can choose not to. And there's no oversight. It's one of the few treaties, human rights treaties, that does not have a body that actually regulates and measures how well countries who have signed on to it honor the obligations that they're supposedly under. I think another element that's really important is this crisis has been a long time coming. It's very much in the news right now, but Europeans who have been watching this and watching the Arab Spring and watching the fallout in places like Syria have been predicting this for years, and nothing has been done. So I think, you know, one thing you do see in the media quite a lot is the tremendous dysfunction revealed within the European Union about what to do with refugees. They've been working on a protocol that would unify their position on refugees for over 10 years and have not come to any sort of agreement about it. So this is a crisis foretold in many ways. And just the last thing I want to say is that I think that a lot of attention is on Europe right now. A lot of attention is on people who are crossing these very dangerous waters. But still, to this day, 80% of the refugees of the Arab Spring are still in the Middle East or are still in countries like Pakistan and Jordan and Lebanon, which Miriam mentioned. Lebanon, 1 in 3 people in Lebanon today is a refugee. So I think that the focus on Europe has sort of distorted a little bit the fact that other countries are really pitching in and doing their best, but without the kind of resources that would guarantee what should be a decent standard of living for refugees. So I look forward to the conversation.
Thank you so much for having me. It's good to be here, and thank you for the format. I love that we only have 5 minutes. When I thought about what should I say in 5 minutes, independent of Robin, we actually came up with the same idea, which is to focus on these key terms, because these key terms tell you so much. It helps clarify what's going on if you understand the terms, and if you don't, so much of this makes no sense. Just driving over here, listening to NPR, these terms get interchanged so often it makes for great confusion. So let me spell out the 4 terms that I think are crucial, very much along your lines, but with a slight twist. Migrants, immigrants, refugees, and asylum seekers. Migrants being the overarching term of people who move across international borders. And then, like Robin says, national and international law insist on this clear distinction between those who move voluntarily and those who are forced to flee. Those who move voluntarily are immigrants who usually move for economic betterment. And Europe is very clear on this. They are not interested and never have been interested in accepting immigrants. America, Canada, Australia, those are countries of immigration. They're used to accepting immigrants. We don't do that. We're not interested in it. At most, we accept guest workers, but that's a whole other issue I won't go into. But of course, because we're good, solid democracies, we accept refugees. That's not the controversy. The controversy, and like Robin says, refugees are defined as people who are persecuted by reasons of their race, religion, nationality, or political opinion. And all these European countries essentially accept the 1951 convention definition that Robin points out. The controversy is not, should we Europeans accept refugees? Of course we accept refugees. The controversy is, what exactly constitutes a refugee? And that's what brings up the third, the fourth group, the asylum seekers. Asylum seekers are just what the name implies. They are seekers of asylum. They are people who come into Europe seeking asylum, seeking protection, essentially being self-declared refugees. They're saying, I am a refugee. You need to grant me asylum. But as Robin says, it's not up to them to really to determine who is a refugee. That's up to each individual country. And what's happened over and over and over in all these countries, over all these years, over all these decades, since I started paying attention to this in the early 80s, is that the vast majority of asylum seekers are rejected as not being true refugees. They're just economic immigrants. Yes, you might have a rough at home, and we're sorry about that, but that's not a ground for asylum. For you to get refugee status in Europe, you need to be a refugee, as defined by UNHCR, as interpreted very narrowly by us. So these tens of thousands of people, these asylum seekers, are coming north. They want to be accepted as refugees. What will happen to them is very unclear. And there's a, let me just finally say, there's a, ultimately, I think, to this, a real dishonesty to how Europe's handling this. Because what they're saying is, in so many cases when they reject the asylum seekers, you're not in enough danger at home to be granted asylum. But you're in too much danger to send you home. Mm-hmm. And it's actually remarkable how often these asylum seekers who are rejected are not sent home, because that is the one area of international law that is fairly well respected, this principle of non-refoulement, that you cannot send people back into danger. Well, that policy, as stated or as executed, really doesn't make sense. I mean, either someone is in danger at home and they should be granted asylum, or they're not in danger at home and they should be sent back. But Europe does not want to make those decisions. So oftentimes, these asylum decisions get drawn out for months and even years, and leave people in just a terrible limbo. And I think, unfortunately, that's what's gonna happen with so many of these people. So that's just all I wanna say, is how important it is to keep these terms in mind. And I think journalists use them interchangeably, sometimes carelessly, but I think politicians oftentimes use them very deliberately in certain ways and not in other ways. So migrants, immigrants, refugees, and asylum seekers. Thanks.
Hi, I will also try to stay with the 5 minutes. Yeah. So I'm a physician and I worked in the humanitarian field for 13 years before coming to the US and coming to the UNC. And I was working in many crises, including the Syrian crisis, and I was working with Syrian refugees in the Middle East, mainly with the ICRC, the International Committee of the Red Cross, as a physician, but working on many other issues. I would like to share and say that establishing a connection firsthand with a victim, it's different from what you hear and what you see in news or you read from a book or when you watch a movie. Well, these stories that you hear in the field, they are so powerful, and in a way they are inspiration. I mean, they make you do your best always for them. And among the crises, I mean, within the crisis nowadays, I would like to share two things. The victims of the conflict, they are still staying in camps. They can't go to Europe, because if you want to go to Europe with those people nowadays, you need to have at least $10,000 per person. So you pay $5,000, $6,000 to a smuggler, and then you need to have some more money to eat and to drink. But still, the victims are suffering and they are staying in the refugee camps in Turkey, Lebanon, Iraq, and in Jordan also. The other thing, and for sure this is a business, I mean, and smugglers are making billions out of that, and they are mainly based in Greece. And they have offers, and they say to refugees, we can take you by a taxi or by a boat or by a train or by a plane even sometimes. So what you see, it's just the tip of the iceberg, and there are more many other things that going on in there. The second thing that I would like to share, that those people not all are from Syria. There are Afghanis, Pakistanis, Iraqis, Iranis, and some others, even from Eritrea. They come into Turkey and they now try to go to Europe. So they are not all Syrians, maybe the majority, even maybe not. So I'm open, I will be open to questions and answers, and thank you so much.
Hi. I've timed this pretty closely, but since this panel is called Breaking News, I do want to speak to some of the headlines today, specifically something that candidate Mike Huckabee said. Let's be clear. Syrians are not refugees. They're not fleeing their country because they want cable TV. I think we all know that. But to reinforce what Professor Cooke said, what they are fleeing, because 260,000 civilians have been killed in the conflict. They lived in a country that, even before the conflict, the government was based on torture, detention of people without trial, disappearances, and the muzzling of all opposition. Add to that, after the conflict, the use of military weapons that specifically target civilians. This mass starvation, the snipers that would attack people scrounging for food among weeds, plus the actions of groups like ISIS and other rebel groups. This is the reason why people are fleeing the country. Now, I'm supposed to talk about how Amnesty has built a mass grassroots campaign on this action. And we did so because people got frustrated that they felt like they couldn't do something successful in Syria. And the refugee issue actually offered an option for them to take action. And specifically, the goal of the UNHCR, the refugee organization of the UN, to resettle 400,000 people among the 4 million people registered in the UN camps. So I'm going to add another word, resettlement, because that is taking people who are registered as refugees in these camps and moving them. The UN says this needs to be done to keep these camps sustainable and to keep the host countries stable. But that is getting kind of confused among all of this activity going in Europe, because when Germany says they'll take 800,000 refugees. That's showing real leadership, but it actually doesn't do anything for the 400,000 people the UN has registered for resettlement. When the wealthy GCC countries say, yeah, bring them on, we need migrant workers, that again shows no leadership and solves nothing in dealing with the UN goal. And when President Obama says, we will now, after a long period of inaction, says we will take 10,000, that does help. That is specifically part of the resettlement goals that we're facing. But it's nowhere near good enough to show real leadership in solving this problem. And it's worth noting, for a number of reasons, who qualifies in the UN for those 400,000. The people who are getting priorities are torture survivors, people with serious medical conditions and disabilities, children and teens on their own, people persecuted for their sexuality or gender, and women and children at risk. There is, in short, a real gender component to this whole issue and this whole campaign that we're facing to get these 400,000 people resettled in other countries. We started long ago, very early, with a Tumblr action, and for about 3 years, Amnesty activists have been posting their photos through social media saying, we are open to Syrian resettlement. The response has been, of the community, the world community, has been pathetic. In some cases, absolutely disgraceful. And it's only now, with these images of the past month, that people have stepped forward. I want to step back a little bit and talk about some of the challenges of running a campaign, and then I will leave the last for questions. Social media campaigns, grassroots campaigns, have to avoid making the Syrian people victims. They have to have ownership of their stories. They have to have control of their narratives. And we have made the face of the campaign 2 4-year-old twins who have suffered a lot of hardships, but the campaign, the story they want to tell is not the hardships that they faced as Syrian Kurds with their father in a wheelchair who suffered torture. What they want to talk about is how successful and how hopeful they are for their future in Sweden once they were resettled through this campaign. So we have to avoid making them victims and give them ownership of their own narratives. We have to have a single standard so that when the U.S., the U.S. media right now is really interested in making the GCC take leadership, and they should. But we can't use criticism of the GCC to avoid the U.S. taking leadership as well. And the final thing is that it won't work unless the groundwork is done before the headlines. If we not worked for these 3 years beforehand, we would not have been ready to do something effective when these the world's attention turned in large amount in these past weeks. And
thank you. I'm sorry, I'm realizing that I didn't insist that everybody mention their name and the title. The two students can give their names and their title.
Hello, my name is Semin Akib, and I'm an undergraduate here at Duke, and I'll be talking about my experiences this summer working specifically with Iraqi and Syrian refugees in Jordan. And before I'd gone to Jordan, I actually had the opportunity to work with refugees here in Durham, resettled Iraqi refugees specifically, and I had the opportunity to help them or help tutor them in English with an organization called Supporting Women's Action, which is here at Duke. So like I said, this past summer, I got to go to, so I'll specifically be talking about my experiences with refugees and the lives of refugees in Jordan. So like I said, I had the opportunity to go to Jordan with Duke Engage for 2 months, and I lived and worked in Amman with an NGO called the Collateral Repair Project. And this NGO, I'll talk a little bit about it later, but specifically the refugees in Jordan, majority of them are actually in cities and not in refugee camps. And in living in cities, they're expected to live in apartments, pay rent, and provide for their families, which is kind of problematic because at the same time, they're legally not allowed to work. So a lot of them resort to working illegally. And some of them do have aid from organizations like the UNHCR, but the UNHCR recently has been having to pull that aid out in order to account for more refugees. So when I worked in Jordan with CRP, the Collateral Repair Project, I worked with Syrian and Iraqi refugees, and many of these had come from, they faced persecution in their countries of origin, so they had to be, they went to Jordan. And CRP, which is like a lot of NGOs in Jordan, they're trying to provide aid and they're trying to help these refugees as best they can. However, some of them, like CRP, are smaller, and a lot of their what they can do is based on what money they can get. And as an international NGO, they're expected to raise funds to help provide for these refugees. So CRP actually had two parts to their mission, and they focused primarily on emergency aid, which included giving food vouchers for refugees to help provide for their families and help them feed their families. And the other part of it was a community center, which offered courses to help with PTSD and things like English courses and computer classes to help them develop skills, which would be necessary for resettlement. So all of the refugees that I interacted with at the center were waiting to be resettled. So they were expecting to be resettled into countries in Europe or to the United States. And the issue with this is that resettlement, or they're expecting resettlement to be, or waiting for resettlement between 3 months or something small to many years. So they don't actually know when they will be resettled. But until then, they're expected to, they're expecting these NGOs like CRP to help support them. And CRP, they actually would assess refugees and would see how much aid they could give, because they didn't have as much money to give or as much aid that they could give to these refugees because they were smaller. So they would actually have these interviews with these refugees and asked about if they were receiving any aid, if they had any money saved up, or how much their rent would be each month. So I actually had the opportunity to sit in on some of these interviews. And the interviews that I saw, the interviewer was actually quite distrusting of the refugees. And I afterwards had the opportunity to ask, like, why didn't you believe what they were saying? Like, why were you second-guessing everything they were telling you? And he told me it was because the refugees that he'd spoken with or that he'd interacted with, a lot of them were reliant on lying. Like, they had to go to multiple NGOs. He called it shopping. They went to multiple NGOs to try and get as much aid as they possibly could for their families, to try and make sure that they're going to have meals on the table for their families, for themselves. So they would rely on lying and working illegally just to support their families, which I thought was really sad, honestly, because I was seeing these people and I saw that they were suffering, and I saw that they were suffering in their country of origin. They were suffering in Iraq or in Syria, and then they came to Jordan and their suffering wasn't over. They were still expected to provide for their families, and then they simultaneously can't work. So it was just very, I think, contradicting. I spoke to some of these refugees in person. I asked them how they felt being in Jordan, if they were hopeful for the future, that kind of thing. And all of them told me they wanted to go back home. And home for them was Iraq or Syria. And what was really unfortunate was that there actually wasn't an opportunity for them to go back, or wasn't possible for their own safety. However, they were all still very positive, and I thought that was really powerful. They were positive for the future. They were hopeful that they were going to be resettled somewhere in Europe, somewhere in the US, and they could live their lives, pick their lives back up, and they were just really positive. I thought that was really powerful, and that they maintained faith. And I did hear some kind of sad stories, and I just thought it was really amazing that they maintained not happiness, but positivity. Okay, well, thank you, and I am excited for questions.
Hi, everyone. My name is Peter Cooke. I'm a junior undergraduate at UNC. This past summer, I spent working with Syrian refugees in Paris, and I've written a quick piece that I think I'm just going to read so I don't miss any major points. But these refugees, unfortunately, are considered to be the lucky ones in this crisis, because we look to the refugees in the crowded camps of Lebanon, Jordan, and Turkey and their dire circumstance, and we don't realize that the refugees in major cities like Paris face extreme hardships as well. So my first experience working face-to-face with refugees was last fall in Durham with the UNC In Jazz Club. Meeting several Iraqi families and hearing their stories of survival and displacement inspired me to pursue this experience along the same line of work. And so my time in Paris was split between two main activities. And the majority of my weekdays were spent working in a small office of the city hall of the 20th arrondissement of Paris, where Syrian asylum seekers of all backgrounds would come for advice and consultation on the asylum seeking process, with, of course, the goal of receiving refugee status. Due to my study of French and Arabic, I was able to assist in the office with explaining government paperwork and walking Syrians through the different steps of this asylum seeking process. Many of our clients knew little to no French at all, or had experienced very traumatic events, preventing them from thinking and operating at full speed. In addition to working in the office, I accompanied Syrians to local administrative offices, such as the police station, the Office for Refugee Protection, and the Court of Asylum Rights. This arduous and tedious process to receive refugee status would take way too long to explain in this quick 5 minutes, so I'll briefly highlight some of the major components that shed a light on the lack of preparation and effective organization of the French government in order to expedite and facilitate the process of accommodating refugees. Before even beginning the mountains of paperwork, almost entirely in French, asylum seekers must receive a voucher, or récépissé, form from the police station. Many times, I stood in line with refugees, or asylum seekers, at 6 in the morning, behind a line of over 200 other asylum seekers, in order to attempt to receive this document, this crucial document. And 2 out of 4 times that I went, we waited 6 hours in line, eventually got to the front, and spoke with the woman at the front desk, who told us that we needed a rendezvous or an appointment, which wasn't part of their official policy at all. So this was just one of the examples that I thought really pointed to just the complete lack of organization and spread of knowledge about what the process really is for these refugees. A lot of it is just up in the air. You're waiting in long lines, and you find out after these long, long hours of waiting. After receiving the voucher form, French asylum seekers have less than 3 weeks to type out an explanation of why they need asylum and why they fear returning to their homes in Syria. This document is then circulated through a 4-month review process, after which the asylum seeker is interviewed, or rather interrogated, to confirm that their responses, filtered through a provided translator, align with the claims of persecution and threat in their written story. This interview is then mulled over for another 5 to 7 months before the verdict is given. And the verdict is either 10 years of refugee status, 1 year, or nothing at all. For the all too often third case scenario of complete rejection, one is allowed to appeal the ruling. This adds yet another complex set of bureaucratic steps after a full year drowning in paperwork and day-to-day struggle. As though the bureaucratic nightmare were not enough, asylum seekers must simultaneously address a variety of necessities, including getting jobs, establishing Social Security, and finding housing. I heard countless stories of overly crammed apartment complexes, inhospitable landlords, and frequently Syrians resorting to sleeping with their families in the streets and parks of Paris. The second main aspect of my time in Paris was a series of interviews I completed with Syrian refugees from a variety of backgrounds. Some of the more interesting interviews were with journalists, ex-political prisoners, and even a Free Syrian Army general. Each interview provided personal insight into the grim realities of the Syrian war zone, as well as a diverse collection of vivid stories of escape, migration, and painstaking resettlement in France. Hearing the stories of torture, mutilation, civilian massacre, and rape pushed me to ask each interview be the desperate question, what can we as foreign outsiders, as Americans, possibly do to aid the situation? And from the variety of responses came two main points that I heard from almost everyone I spoke to. And one, that we, as concerned and aware Americans and citizens, must take action for the reform of international refugee resettlement process, both here and Europe and abroad. And two, and most importantly, that we have to look beyond the images of refugee clamored trucks in Calais, France, or dead children washed up on the European shores, but we have to look to the source of the problem of this immeasurable humanitarian crisis, which is the regime of Bashar al-Assad and his ruthless reign of terror on the citizens of Syria. Thanks.
Please join me in thanking the panel. So I wanted to leave plenty of time. We have 3/4 of an hour for you, for your questions. And I just wanted to make one point that I think everybody has made just very briefly, and that is that there is such a problem with this conception of the refugee as a problem. That, in fact, the reason that Germany has opened it had opened its borders and wanted 800,000 refugees is that there is a calculation that within 10 years, it will lose 10 million of its population because of the fact that the population is aging. Our country is built on refugees who have come here, who might have been a problem in the beginning, but who are in fact the founders, the builders of the country that we're in. So I hope that we don't go away from this meeting thinking of refugees only as victims, but also as survivors and as assets, possible assets, after each country has invested just something in providing this help for people in terrible need. So I'd like to open it up to you and to your questions.
Thank you so much. I appreciate all the points raised this in this session. But the question is this. There was a time when the international community rallied behind the President of the United States to kick Assad out. The flux of refugees is going on and on. How many thousand Europe can take? There was a solution presented by or suggested by Turkey to create a safe haven for the Syrian people, protected internationally by Europe, NATO. And the example you see, I'm giving you in the 1998, United States and Britain imposed on Iraq an enforced no-fly zone. They kept the north safe to protect the Kurds, the south for the Shia, and they enforced it, and they cornered Saddam and finally kicked him out. But the problem is this. It seems that there is no will to kick Assad out now because of the fear of the jihadists might take over. This is misguided policy. Assad is no less bad than ISIS. This is the core of the problem. Unless this bad regime is gone, you will receive more and more refugees, and there will be a short time when Europe will close its border. Please go back to the root of the problem. The Syrian people, they are very nice people. They don't want to migrate, but they are forced out because of the bad regime. And the son of Syrian immigrant who gave us the smartphone, Steve Jobs, is a Syrian also. His father was an immigrant, you see. Mm-hmm. Well, please, the foreign policy adopted by United States and Europe also is misguided. They don't want to intervene, wait and see, and there is no strategy. It is day-to-day business. The problem is there, inside Syria. The Syrians, they want to live peacefully there, find job there, and set thine inside their territory, please. This is the problem. It should be settled there. Thank you.
Thank you. Any comments from the panel?
Yes, I could comment.
Yes, please.
I think you're absolutely right that we can find different moments where different decisions could have been made, and I think in particular President Obama is someone who was already dealing with a number of different wars. So the idea, I mean, this comment he made about the red line of chemical weapons in Syria was made, that was a moment. But I think the American administration just didn't have the will to get involved in another military action, even if it was a no-fly zone. And I remember very clearly the generals telling him, look, it's a no-fly zone, but that isn't necessarily going to solve the problem. So there was a lot of discussion in the administration at the time. But, you know, from a human rights perspective, I think a number of people have suggested that Syria will be President Obama's Rwanda, that this is going to be a problem that continues to unfold and will, in the fullness of time, mark his administration. Obviously, Rwanda is a little different in the sense that it was very concentrated a month in 1994 in April, and this is a problem that has unfolded over time. But I think that there's a lot of questioning that needs to go on now about the decisions that were made. But I think the one take home, and I take Jeffrey's point about this, the only way things are going to change, the only way they've ever changed, is that the citizens of these countries take action and press their leaders for decisions to protect people. And it's not just the Europeans that need to do this. We as Americans need to do this. That figure that Jeffrey quoted of 10,000 people is a joke.
Yeah.
We've resettled hundreds of thousands of people during the Vietnam, in the aftermath of the Vietnam War, during the 1980s when we gave temporary protected status to Central Americans, to Salvadorans, to Guatemalans, and allowed them to come into the United States, and a lot of those people eventually went back. I'm not standing up for the health of Central America at this point, but there are a number of different things that we could do as Americans that would at least partially help address this crisis, and we're not seeing a lot of leadership coming from Washington.
Thank you, Robin. Another question? Yes.
Thank you very much. I'm Bolin, a master student in global health. I think a couple of panelists mentioned the terms and definitions for either refugees or migrants. So I'm wondering what if there is a group of people inside the territory of the country, but not officially recognized as citizens of the country, and there's still conflict going on. For example, the Rohingyas in Rakhine State in Myanmar, how are they defined? I mean, usually these kind of people, refugees or IDPs or others.
If you're within the international borders of your country, but you've been displaced because of violence, that would be a displaced person. There's no treaty that protects you. There is a document of principles about how displaced people should be treated. But the bar for protection is much lower. For instance, in Colombia, when I worked on this issue in Colombia, people would be attacked, and they were considered, you know, sort of almost as if they had been the victims of a natural disaster. When they got aid, it was very little, and it was very grudging. And the government never really addressed the security issue, whether attacks by paramilitaries or attacks by guerrillas. So the displaced person is truly without protection, whereas there's at least a nod to protection. You know, as Nick was talking about, you know, asylum seekers or refugees, there's a nod to protection there. But when you're a displaced person, you're really at the mercy of sort of the beneficence of whatever government you're dealing with.
Thank you. At the back.
So as a senior who's looking to work in this field next year after I graduate, a lot of you mentioned multiple legal barriers and obstacles towards solving this problem, and this can be discouraging to hear. So I'm curious what your thoughts are on how like innovative grassroots solutions can navigate these legal obstacles. Thank you.
Great. Panel. Yeah, the students.
I guess from what I've seen from NGO
work, can you talk into
From NGO work, there was a sense of productivity and getting things done. Like for example, with Association Aviv that I worked with in Paris, there was another association that they worked with. I forget the name of it, but it was for lodging these refugees, and they had a cohesive method of placing refugees in the most need into apartment complexes, into condos in Paris. So I think with the right initiative, the productivity is very capable. It's capable, but I think that the bigger issue at hand is the need for change in government policy, because these little actions of NGOs are really not getting us very far. But then you can be productive, so I wouldn't discourage you from getting into the field.
Sama, did you want to add?
Well, I agree with what Peter said. And also I think that the NGOs there are a lot of NGOs in these countries of, I think like the first point of entry for refugees, so the first country they can go to after the country where their country of origin that they're fleeing. And there are a lot of different organizations that can, or that have been helping. So in some way they're providing aid or they're just trying to support these refugees. And I think it is making a big difference, but at the same time, like if you're helping a refugee while they're waiting to be resettled, I think they still need to be able to be resettled into another country, or they need to be able to actually leave that country. So I think a lot of that is policy-based.
Can I just add?
Yes, of course.
I would follow the example of the students and try to work with NGOs. I'm discouraged by European refugee policies. I can't see that changing anytime really soon in a way that would really address this problem, which, of course, as you said, really needs to go back to the root causes. I mean, it all starts there. But work with NGOs on the ground to try to alleviate as much suffering as you can in the short and medium term, so maybe in the long term something more productive comes about.
Professor Kunz.
I would just like to add to the optimism and just remind everybody that we read the headlines about government, that is to say political officials, all over Europe making hostile comments, because they're all of them facing extreme but minority right-wing anti-immigrant feeling, racist feelings. But if you look one step deeper at the public opinion surveys, you find enormous support for the NGOs that are doing, that you would like to work with, that are doing their thing, that provide their workers with an overwhelming sense of the problem, but also a very rewarding sense of satisfaction. This summer, even in Serbia, the pariah nation of Europe, we found great grassroots collaboration in helping out the refugees who barely escaped from Greece and Macedonia. So just look small for the grassroots.
I think it was Pope Francis that said that each family should just take in one family. I mean, it's one at a time. Yes.
I would like to add to this. I happen to be from Hungary. So, and in So in the, of course, in the past 2 weeks, I was following this crisis closely, and what I was totally missing from all the news coverage is the support that the Hungarian people show to the refugees. And this is not a new thing. They have been doing this for months and months, since early spring, at least. This is a grassroots movement that started within the people, not the major charity organizations like Maltans or the Baptist Aid, just withdrew themselves. They found the migrant crisis too controversial, so they didn't want to involve. And then what happened, just local people started helping the refugees, feeding them, keeping them alive, and doing much, much, much more than that, which included like providing haircutting, shaving services, medical help, sitting down and drawing with children, screening movies for them, preparing like small packages for Eid for the refugee children in the camps and in the stations. So they were doing enormous work, and they are still doing it, and they monitor the situation very closely. They know exactly what is needed and where. They have a daily changing list of items needed, and donations are just pouring in. They can't keep up with donations. There's so much, and volunteers are pouring in, and everyone really helps. And I don't see this in the coverage. I don't know why. And I know for sure that such organization work in Slovenia and in Serbia. I don't know about Macedonia or Greece, but I assume that there are people with good feelings everywhere. And you see pictures of refugees with tents and mattresses. And those tents and mattresses, they don't bring with themselves from Turkey. They get them on the way. So in every country, this must be going on, but there's very little coverage. All we see is that the Austrians were receiving the refugees with chocolate and whatever, and the Germans were receiving the refugees with teddy bears and chocolate. But that is not, you know, they are not the only ones. There are, of course, I cannot be proud of my country because there are lots of racist people and primitive people, but the opposite is true as well.
Thank you for that beautiful example of the difference between the state and the. Of course, we saw the British who crossed the channel to help the refugees in Calais who are camping out in horrible circumstances. Again, we go back to help at the person-to-person level. Thank you. Anyone here want to comment on this? Yes, please.
I have one point, and maybe one solution would be to mobilize the Arabic countries. They have resources, they are in the Middle East, and they are kind of like similar to the culture of the Syrians and Iraqis. Maybe we can mobilize them and engage them and try to put some pressure on them and just tell them, move on and be involved in that issue. Maybe this is another solution.
Dilshad, since you didn't take up your time, yep. I wonder if you could just give us a minute or two about your work in health, humanitarian work.
Yeah, so I mean, as I mentioned earlier, I was involved in complex emergencies mainly, and in the Middle East for sure, and working in conflict zones, dealing with refugees and some other issues around that, but mainly on health issues. I mean, day by day, I came to realize that most of the dissertations, articles, policy papers had their limits, and on ground, nothing is working. And it's different. So, coming to academia after that, I have a bit like a different point of view on things, because here in academia, we talk about policies, articles, papers, while on ground, it's very difficult to apply it and to see it and to work with. And I mean, now we can see that we failed with the Ebola. Now we are failing with this crisis, and God knows what challenge we might face soon, and also we fail to handle. So, yeah.
Thank you. Yes, Azadi.
So, I asked some Saudis who happen to be here in town about that same question, because the Gulf states were, you know, trying to be apologetic, or they tried to say, yes, we have taken some Syrian refugees in the hundreds of thousands. That's why I heard, and of course that's unverified. But then again, the question is, if you ask these Syrian refugees a choice between going to Germany or settling in Saudi Arabia or in UAE, and they'll tell you definitely Germany, even though the language and the culture and everything is the same, just because the citizenship, they would not get it even if they stay there 30 years.
So that's one thing. And just one broad statement. I think I'm trying to see what's the catalyst event. That, of course, we have to go back to that picture. It's very symbolic. It's that picture that triggered the Damir al-Alami, you know, the global conscience as to this thing, which brings the fact, I think that personally, yes, I like Salma's optimism, but if I were you, I would still be kind of brought down by this global indifference to human suffering. I think we've started consuming images of people dying by the hundreds and thousands, and actually refugees have been drowning in ships trying to cross, to Europe for years now. And each time I'm not sure if there's anybody counting, you know, like the hundreds. Some of them are unaccounted for. Nobody knows how many were actually in the ship. And I want to go back to resettlement. Of course, resettlement, yes, for people who are successfully resettled. But unfortunately, I was also disillusioned to speak to people who have been resettled here in the U.S. I'm talking about Iraqi refugees. I'm not going to talk even about the trauma that they still carry and hasn't been addressed. And I think in the medical field, I mean, I see a lot of people getting actually the services just to deal with trauma because they've witnessed a lot of torture and everything. But when they come here, it's the disillusionment. Because they are supported only for a few months to kind of get a job, and then they have to get a job, they have to support themselves. And some of them simply can't because of their disabilities, because of the language, because of, you know. So, and some of them have told me, frankly, that Saddam's days were much better than this. And they wish they could go back to living under a dictatorial regime, have more dignity, and they have stability.
Comments from the panel?
I've dealt with a number of resettled refugees, and I've heard stories. In fact, there are several tragic ones, people who have gone back to Egypt after just not being able to live in New York, and now they're back in New York because they couldn't live in Egypt there, too. I think the point isn't that resettlement is not a solution, because it is a necessity. I think the point is that we have to do a better job of making it work better. And it's not cheap. Fortunately, just in the last decade, there have been several new centers have sprung up around the U.S. that specifically give psychological care to torture victims and victims of other violence. They specialize in that. But that doesn't necessarily mean a person will be resettled in a place that's anywhere near there. But again, I get back to the point, resettlement is a necessity at this point. But it needs to be done better. I completely understand where you're coming from.
Thank you. In the back.
Hi, my name is Austin Edwards, and I am a Master's of Public Policy student here at Duke. In the international community. This past summer, the UN Development Program, and one of the things I very crudely, the rhetoric of cold realities, this sort of assumption that if the public just knew the scope and the scale of the suffering and these atrocities, then the public opinion would automatically switch, and a lot of our political sold or taken to other countries. Or the political capacity to take these refugees. And you see that even as public opinion is moving in Europe, it still takes a more nuanced position than you might see in the advocacy arena. So, for example, which source nations should refugees be taken from, how long should support be guaranteed if they're granted refugee status, things like that. And you see that in Germany and Austria's taking advantage of the closures that are allowed to them under the Schengen Agreement. So what the international community and national political realities and of these sovereign countries, and where do you see the really just a difference in moral opinion? And if that's still a difficulty for the advocacy community, what do you see as sort of the broader implications it has for the refugee crisis?
Thank you. Robin?
It's a great question. I am sensitive to the cold reality thing because, you know, this is a geopolitical issue. I mean, Russia has been funding Assad. We don't want to touch Russia. You know, we've got, you know, the Iraq, we've got ISIS, we've got Afghanistan. It's a mess, you know. And so from the perspective of Washington or Geneva or London, you know, you're thinking globally, you're thinking about power alliances and all that. So it's, yes, those politicians are going to be needing to think about this. You're also going to need to think about resources, absolutely. I think, though, that what I've seen lacking most is leadership. And I think Angela Merkel, even though, you know, perhaps we want more from Germany, I think she has really shown a kind of leadership about this that is new and exciting and is the kind of thing that we're not seeing elsewhere, where somebody says, look, this is a crisis, this is going to affect us. You know, there was that famous little clip of her making the little girl cry. And, you know, and it was, Claudia's going to kill me here, but, you know, she was actually telling the little girl the truth. It was not the right moment. but now she has her right moment, and she's telling the German people the truth. We have an obligation because of our past, because of our wealth, because of our leadership within the European community. But, you know, we also have to say to the rest of the world, we have our limits. We have our limits, and we need more support from the European Union. And you're not getting that kind of support from the UK. We'll see with Corbyn just being elected as the leader of the Labour Party. We'll see if that changes. I would like to see more leadership from the United States. We just lost a prime minister in Australia. You know, Australia's been one of the countries that's been pushing migrant boats back out into the water. Mm-hmm. There needs to be a change there. I go back to what I said earlier, the only way that's going to change is for people to move to push their legislators to having a different point of view about this. But yes, I mean, this has been a huge issue in the UK, and it's given rise to a new political party, which is profoundly anti-immigrant. You know, and Claudia mentioned the profoundly kind of racist and anti-immigrant movements in places like Hungary or places like Greece. You know, we do have a global crisis here that's going to reach into all sorts of areas of life. And I would just end by saying, you know, make no mistake, this is going to change Europe profoundly. And I'm just quoting Angela Merkel here, but she was saying the other day to the younger generation of Germans, this is going to change your country forever. So I'm not going to have to deal with that, but you are. So, be aware of what you're asking for here. If we, you know, resettle 800,000 or double that, you know, a million Syrian or Iraqi or Eritrean refugees, that means we as a nation are going to be fundamentally different in 10 years. And I think that is something that I think really hasn't been dealt with by other leaders. And I really tip the hat to her that she's been brave enough and visionary enough to say this to the people so that she's walking with them as opposed to, you know, having them be, you know, having the German population, you know, pushing behind. Mm-hmm. But she's really showing a way forward, I think. That's at least my point of view.
Yeah, just, let me say, Germany has been historically the most generous European country in accepting asylum seekers. I mean, that is hands down far more generous than the Brits, for example,
or us, or the United States.
Or the U.S. Mm-hmm. It's been the most strange. So keep that in mind with the Germans. Speaking of cold reality, I'm glad you brought that up. To some extent, one more thing about the Europe, let me remind you, the EU has a population of 500 million. That is a huge number of people, and it's just dropping the buckets when they talk about tens of thousands. I think someone just announced they want to accept 500. I said, yeah. You got to be kidding
50.
Me.
It was 50. Iceland is going to take 50.
About the cold reality, though, let me point. an asylum decision to grant a refugee asylum is an explicit critique of the sending country. That has always been the case. That goes a long way explaining why the U.S. is not at all eager to accept a lot of Iraqi refugees, because you would be condemning the government of Iraq for not being able to take care of its people, which is the government that you went in to set up. And this is the classic, which is the Nicaraguan versus El Salvador. The U.S. was very quick to accept Nicaraguan refugees in the 80s because we were supporting the Contras to overthrow the Sandinistas. We did not accept El Salvadorans very readily because we were supporting the government. So a lot of this really, I think, goes back to the Cold War mentality, 1951. Mm-hmm. It's easy to handle refugees if it's a handful of white Christian nuclear physicists coming from the Soviet Union who were economically and ideologically beneficial. That worked well, but we're in a completely different reality and have been since really the late 70s, and Europe just simply has not adapted its refugee policies to this new reality, which is why I think it's such a mess and will continue to be such a mess.
Jeff. Let me just a quick point about cold realities. If you think it's bad now, you heard the numbers of Lebanon, and Jordan is pretty close to it in terms of proportion of refugees. If you think it's bad now, just wait till, if that refugee number doesn't go down in those countries, until those countries collapse upon themselves because of the cold reality of what they're trying, the burdens that they're taking right now. The world can't ignore it.
Anyone else? Okay. Yeah. Maybe the students, start with the students.
Yeah, I think the first thing we could point to is right now there's a U.S. petition going around for President Obama to accept more than the 10,000 that he stated. So right off the bat, there's that petition. And I think something that a lot of the refugees I spoke to, something that they kept reiterating was the fact that it needs to be part of the daily conversation. I mean, you see it on the news all the time and then you turn it off and continue with your day. But rather, I mean, on a daily basis, just talking with people, making people aware of the situation, I mean, I think that's what changes opinions.
Someone? I'd like to add to that. I think also if people or younger people can get involved with not only the discussion or the discourse on this, but to actually go out and get involved in the refugee community, in the resettled community with, there are a lot of Iraqi and Sudanese refugees here in Durham specifically. So I think if people can go out and try and interact with these people, it'll make it more more tangible. It'll feel more real because you'll actually be able to talk to these people and hear about what they've gone through, in person. I think it's very different from just hearing statistics and working with smaller organizations. And also, if I can go back to the point of the cold reality, I think it's interesting that I think one of the reasons why the U.S. is very unaccepting of refugees, specifically Arab, Iraqi refugees, and just Middle Eastern refugees, I think part of it is kind of a racial tension. So I think since 9/11, in this post-9/11 country that we're living in, I think there's been a lot more, I don't want to use the word Islamophobia, but there's been a lot more...
Go ahead.
Islamophobia. And racism specifically towards Arabs because they're terrorists. Why would we let them into our country? So I think if you were to compare the U.S. to Jordan, so Jordan has I think about half of the population of Jordan is Palestinian or originally Palestinian. So they completely integrated this entire population, almost a large population of the actual country of Palestine or the state of Palestine. So they've integrated these people into their country. So they're now, if you ever meet someone in Jordan, they either have to say they're Jordanian or Jordanian Palestinian, because that's
It's been a crisis for over 50 years. So I think that's quite a stark contrast to the United States, where people are like, oh no, they're different from us. Oh no, they're a different race from us. They're a different culture. So I think if the U.S., if majority of American population supported this, then I think President Obama and the government would be more willing to accept these refugees, specifically Arab refugees. Because I understand that here in like the world of academia and people are liberal in their opinions of accepting refugees and everyone has a right to live a free life. I think it's different from people who just see refugees or see these Arabs, see these people who are suffering as, oh, they're terrorists. Oh, they're going to affect our country in a bad, in a negative way. Not, oh, they're going to develop new technology. They're going to develop iPhones. They're going to be a part of the United States. So I think that's just, I think that's an interesting contrast.
Let me just quickly add to what someone just said. We have a student association between Duke and UNC called INJES, which is students working with community partners, they're called. So refugees who are resettled here in Durham and the Triangle area. So we are very much open to having more students join with in jazz. Okay. Yeah, I think it's also important just to go back to what Robin was saying, and that is, oh, so Germany 10 years from now is going to be different. Well, America 100 years later from the influx of lots of Arab immigrants is different, but it's better. Yeah.
Hi. This question's probably only relevant for people with experience in law, but I think that applies to a couple of you. So it seems like there are a multitude of gaps, legal gaps, in kind of refugee protection, globally speaking. A couple examples that pop to mind are not every country is a signatory of the Refugee Convention, right? So if they receive refugees, the UNHCR has to do what's called a memoranda of understanding, and the protection that gets afforded through these MOUs is really not that great. So Jordan comes to mind, Lebanon comes to mind, right? At least in the early 2000s, a lot of the refugee protection that was there was not convention refugee protection, it was MOU brokered refugee protection. Another that has been mentioned is a lack of global refugee status determination standards. Mm. Another problem that has kind of come up, I think, in Jeffrey's remarks, is the difference between refugees in camps versus refugees that make it to your territory, and the fact that camps appear nowhere convention, right? They're a completely extra legal invention that some authors have called illegal, right? So there's all of these kind of holes in, if we're thinking of law as a web over the globe, there's all these holes in the law. And I'm wondering if you had to pick which of these holes you think is most damaging for refugee protection, what would you pick to address first?
Thank you. Challenging question. Who's going to take this on?
Well, I'll jump in. I would say it's the lack of oversight. It's the lack of a mechanism where reports can be made, including reports by NGOs, to the UN to say, look, you know, Macedonia is doing this or Hungary is doing that. And even though it's, I mean, I am not the kind of person who can work at the UN. It would drive me absolutely bonkers because it's so slow. But But yet, you know, we've seen, in especially in Latin America, the actions of the Inter-American Commission on Human Rights related to the Inter-American Court have fundamentally changed the way we deal with issues like torture and disappearance and even indigenous rights. So, but that's because there's an oversight mechanism where countries, through the courts or through the court of public opinion, can be brought to account for their failures to respect certain kinds of human rights. And we don't have that with refugees. We don't have oversight. So I, you know, for me at least, I think that there should be some kind of a commission that is empowered to collect reports, and especially reports from NGOs about the noncompliance issues, and that these can be brought to the European Court, for example. Because there really have been changes in Europe resulting from European Court of Human Rights decisions. So we need some sort of it's just a structural thing, a way to bring information to bear and then to lead to change. That would be mine.
Great. Other? Niklaus, do you want to?
I'm not a lawyer, so I'm
okay.
Passing on that one.
I think we have time for one more question. We'll make it two then. And
hi.
Please just say who you are.
Okay, my name is Manal. I'm associated with UNC. I have a question to Mr. Mark. I happened to work for UNHCR for about 3 years when I was in Damascus in the Iraqi operation, and I know that resettlement is very lengthy. It takes forever to get a refugee to a resettlement country. But you mentioned that the UNHCR is willing or hoping to resettle 400,000 Syrian refugees from host countries, which is nice if it works out. So my question is, how many people have been actually resettled so far?
100,000 is, from what I understand, that's not true. 100,000 places have been processed. People have been processed. Processed is the beginning.
Mm-hmm.
It's not the end.
Not there yet.
So I don't have the number of people. It's very, in the U.S., it's 1,500 people since the beginning of the conflict. 1,500. That's a pathetic number. Yes, and it is slow. And yes, these people left their homes without their documentations that Homeland Security wants to see documentations. And, you know, they have barrel bombs dropping on their house. They're not grabbing them. So these are things that the U.S. has to adopt to and speed the process up.
So what's the role of Amnesty International in the process of resettlement?
We don't have a role except for promoting it. The role is, there are a number of, the UN works through other groups, such as the International Catholic Migration Commission, ICMC. And they actually, once the host country government has approved the person for resettlement, these third parties then take over and help the transition, help that support for the first months that, and so there's a number of wheels moving at the same time. Amnesty International is not part of that process. We are part of the process of promoting political support for resettlement.
Okay.
Thank you. And last question for our new visitor from Shanghai.
Okay, thanks. My name is Jenny from Shanghai. As a visiting researcher here for 1 year, I just come on last Saturday. Okay, my question is that the Europe and the refugees, they solve, I mean that their policy for refugees, they solve refugee as a kind of result. There must be causes and the reasons of the refugee, but the Europeans, the policy, they don't solve that. I mean, it doesn't solve the reasons. So I know that if solve the reasons and causes of the refugee will cost a lot. But also that solve the refugee as a result also costs a lot. So which solution will cost more and how longer term an effect and influence? That's my question. Thanks.
$64,000 question. Anyone want to take it on?
What did Dr. Rumsfeld says, the known unknowns and the unknown unknowns. I think somebody said this, but maybe it was you, Jeffrey. It was that the cost of not doing something is mm-hmm. going to be much higher than the cost of doing something.
Yeah, I think Professor
yes,
Jawad was saying that exactly. also.
You mean something in the region, you mean, or something in Europe?
I think both places. I mean, yeah. addressing the root causes and addressing the refugee flows is going to be less expensive in the end than turning our back on both things. You know, obviously, I think that spending money on the region, it's like, exactly what do you want? Like, do you want to spend money on a no-fly zone? And from a human rights perspective, that gets pretty sticky. You know, when do we advocate for military intervention as a human rights goal?
Mm.
And then we have to accept that that will also create deaths, and there will be civilian casualties inevitably. But, you know, as in with Rwanda, we didn't do it, and we regretted it. We didn't intervene militarily and are still paying the price for that in that part of Africa. Now, to intervene in the Middle East with someone like Assad, I mean, Rwanda was nothing compared to going in militarily against Assad. So is that actually going to improve things, or is that going to make things worse? That's what makes the no-fly zone relatively attractive. It's not boots on the ground. But at this point, is a no-fly zone actually going to help? I would say probably not. And the example of the Kurd, you know, of the no-fly zone over you know, protecting the Kurds, I mean, that was very specific. It was very limited in time. It worked. But that conflict was much less. I don't know if you'd agree. I mean, it was a...
I think there was a will to kick Saddam out.
Right.
This is the reason. But now, kicking Assad out, there is hesitation.
Right.
I would like also to add, I mean, since then, the nature of the conflict changed. I mean, at that time, we had conflict between countries, and that conflict was different. But now, looking at the Middle East, the conflict has been changed. It's totally different from the 80s or the 90s. So this is maybe, it's so complicated. If you decide to do that, you have regional actors, you have other countries, you have many groups on ground. So things changed since the 80s and the 90s, and now it's not applicable anymore.
Well, yeah. With that, I'd like... Okay.
Since the... All right, so does the American...
I'm sorry, can I quickly interrupt? You say, I'm going there. Where's there? Syria?
No, I'm...
We're giving us some hot inside tip.
And as hesitant as the U.S. is, Europe's certainly not going to do that. There's no way Europe's going to put together any kind of military force to
right.
Whoa, why are you going to the Marines? why don't we have the two who are closest to you, right? What do you guys think?
I don't think I have enough expertise to answer if we should be involved militarily in Syria. No, but to answer your question about what you say to your fellow troops or troops that you're leading, I think there's no question that it's a moral responsibility to do something. And if you're leading a troop in Syria, I think that's a moral high ground that tops anything I've ever heard. I mean, the stories I've heard of torture and mutilation and disgusting, terrible things that this regime has done to its people. Mm-hmm. So maybe not from an American perspective. Maybe from an American perspective, this isn't going to change that much. But I think from a humanitarian perspective, it's huge.
I agree. And I think the only issue would be if we're looking at the military and like the actual American people who will be affected. So the people will have family members in the military or family members going over to Syria, people they know going over to Syria. Like you were saying, someone you know, the closest person to military age coming back without an arm. I think that kind of reminds me of the issues with the Iraq war and people going into Afghanistan and Iran. I think that was just... That's my opinion. That's what I'm thinking about. So I'm thinking about how the American population will, how the American people will support this, or if they will support this, just because of the actual Americans who will be affected. So the Americans that go over. But like Peter said, I think from a humanitarian perspective, I think it would make a big difference.
Well, with that, I think we will end this fascinating session and thank our panelists. Thank you.